The team is airborne. Here's some footage of them taking off just moments ago. The spaceflight system was towed out to the runway and elegantly took to the skies on what is a beautiful morning here in the state of New Mexico. They're at approximately 30,000 feet in altitude and climbing as we speak. Our spaceflight system is comprised of two vehicles in a mated configuration. Our mothership Eve, named thoughtfully by Richard after his late mother Eve, and spaceship Unity, named by the late Stephen Hawking as a vehicle that will unite the world through space. Also going to push the stick all the way forward to prepare for release. And things happen pretty quickly after the release. So the pilots are going to light the rocket motor and they're going to accelerate in level flight until they reach Mach 1, at which point they'll start what we call the gamma turn, where we turn directly up and head to space. 1 minute to release now. It's getting real.
So exciting.
We are armed for release. 20 seconds. Five, three, two, one. Release, release, release.
Fire, fire.
Clean release. Ignition. Good rocket motor burn. There's Mach 1 trimming now. Trim complete. Unity is pointed directly up and heading to space. Things are looking great. We are 25 seconds into the burn now, approaching Mach 2. 30 seconds, Mach 2. Everything's looking really good and stable. 40 seconds. 45 seconds. 50 seconds, approaching Mach 3. There's Mach 3. And 60 seconds, and that is a full duration burn, folks. We are headed to space. And the passengers in the back have been cleared to unstrap. Our predicted apogee is 279,000 feet and climbing. The pilots are now unlocking the feather, and as soon as they do that, it's going to initiate a backflip for Spaceship Unity. This is normal. We want those windows pointed down towards the Earth to maximize that incredible view. So Feather is coming up now, and the pilots are also enabling the RCS, or Reaction Control System, which is what they'll use to control the attitude of the vehicle while we're outside the atmosphere. All right, Feather is all the way up. We are at about 250,000 feet now and climbing. As soon as we cross the boundary to space, we'll hear a word from our founder, Sir Richard Branson. Welcome to space, Unity 22.
To all you kids down there, I was once a child with a dream, looking up to the stars. Now, I'm an adult in a spaceship with lots of other wonderful adults looking down to our beautiful, beautiful Earth. To the next generation of dreamers, if we can do this, just imagine what you can do. Hey!
Come on out, Richard.
Recording things on board today, and we'll be sure to capture his magical words and share them with the world when they're available. We reached apogee 282,000 feet. So we are on the re-entry portion of our flight now, and the mission specialists are heading back to their seats. Our training team has worked really hard on this portion of the flight to make it very natural and intuitive for passengers. Now, when we talk about space travel, a lot of people know and expect the boost portion of the flight to be loud and thrilling. But what's interesting is re-entry is also very similar. As supersonic air is flowing over the vehicle in the feathered configuration, shockwaves form on top of the cabin, which are audible to those inside. And for those of you on site watching on the ground, you should be able to hear a double sonic boom as Spaceship Unity once again breaks the sound barrier. And the pilots are lowering the feather now. Now, as the feather comes down, the nose of Spaceship is going to drop. This is normal and expected. Once that feather's down and locked, the pilots will begin a gentle pull up to a level attitude. And I'm hearing the feather is down and locked now. So at this point, Spaceship Unity is a glider, so it's all about balancing her potential and kinetic energy. So if the pilots want to go faster, they point the nose down, and if they want to go slower, they bring the nose up. All right, so I'm so happy we could catch a little part of that. It seems like there's a little bit of a delay in the transmission there. It does have a long way to travel. But you could tell by the smiles on their faces, they just had the ride of their lives. We are so excited for them to land and party the rest of the day with, like astronauts, in the typical Virgin fashion. Now, as the crew and Spaceship make their way across the desert, they are gliding over one of the most remarkable landscapes in the United States and the largest desert in North America, the Chihuahuan Desert. The area around Spaceport includes more than 6,000 square miles of restricted airspace and high desert, which is one of the reasons it was built here. Oh, you can see the chase in the background there outside of Richard's window. The pilots are coordinating with Chase now and discussing their energy management plan. They're at about 9,500 feet in altitude, and the runway out here at Spaceport America is around 4,600 feet in altitude. All right, we have three landing gear down and locked. Now, the pilots are going to be landing on runway 34 today, so that's coming from the south and towards the north for those of you on site watching. And for the non-pilots tuning in, those numbers represent the first two numbers of the magnetic heading of the runway. So, for example, 34 is 340 degrees on your compass. We are just about 1,000 feet above the field now and on final. 500 feet above the runway. 300 feet. Over the threshold. Main gear touchdown. And we're going to hold it just like this for a minute before bringing the nose down. Can see they're already celebrating inside there. And the nose is coming down now. Nose gear, touchdown. And braking. Look at that incredible drone footage here as we come in. And there is full stop.
All right.
A perfect landing. Virgin Galactic 4 mission specialist on board from our operational home base, Spaceport America. A beautiful day of flight. What a moment. Congratulations to everybody on board and, of course, our very own Spaceship Unity who returned to space today. And, of course, we also saw beautiful flying from our Eve crew, CJ and Kelly, and brilliant work by our Chase pilots, Jamil and Patrick, all of whom are still in the air right now. Great job to you all. Now, Chris, you were aboard the ISS for about 5 months at one point, right? Did the view out the window ever get old?
Gosh, no. At the end of my 5 months on the space station, we were getting back into our ship, just sort of like the crew returned today. And just before I got into my spacesuit, I went over to the window just to try and soak up.
Also, you know, my favorite part of it was when you talked about seeing Earth from above and the transformation that it has on people. You know, we call it the overview effect that, you know, I really hope and I'm sure that our astronauts today experience.
So yeah. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
And a wonderful day to be together.
Oh, I really appreciate it. Thank you, guys.
We just witnessed the crew disembark from the spaceship, and what a hero's welcome they received. That was so adorable seeing all the friends and family greet them now officially as astronauts. Now we're gonna give them just a minute here to freshen up. They're entering Gaia now, which is what we call the first level here at Spaceport America. So like I said, they're gonna get an opportunity here to just freshen up.
Traveling here from its birthplace back in Mojave, California.
Currently 200 at 7 knots, altimeter 3008.
At Spaceport America, you have a spaceship.
1,000.
1,000, we're gonna land that runway.
Right on.
New Mexico is really a perfect home for commercial space. It has a rich history in space travel, going back to the start of rocketry here in the United States. It gives us fantastic access and unrestricted airspace to operate our spacecraft. When I think back to a little over 3 years ago at our first captive carry flight for Unity back in Mojave, I said, we all have a dream to make this thing a reality. And here we are, it's finally a reality.